Well, with his new book out this week, former RBI Governor Raghuram Rajan has created quite a buzz as he broke his silence on the controversial note ban. Mr. Rajan has said in his book that he in fact warned against such a move, telling the government last year that the short-term economic costs would outweigh any long-term benefits. His words have only highlighted the many contradictions in the government's version of events leading up to the 8th of November 2016, when the Prime Minister dramatically announced the ban.
Former Reserve Bank Governor Raghuram Rajan has finally broken his silence over demonetization. In his new book, he says that in February 2016, the government had asked for his views on demonetization. Although there might be long-term benefits, he said then, I felt the likely short-term economic costs would outweigh them and there were potentially better alternatives. I made these views known in no uncertain terms. Rajan also said he had handed over a note to the government outlining the potential cost and benefits of scrapping the higher denomination currency. It also emphasized that preparation would be required to do such an exercise and that the RBI flagged what would happen if preparation was inadequate. Rajan says at no point during my term was the RBI asked to make a decision on demonetization. Here are the contradictions in the government's version. Replying to an RTI in December 2016, the RBI had said the design of the new 500 and 2000 rupee banknotes was approved at the May 19, 2016 meeting of the Central Board of the RBI. Rajan resigned in September. So who is telling the truth? The RTI reply oddly says the bank cannot disclose the name of the governor who approved the design. Interestingly, a letter signed by Raghuram Rajan on the 29th of August 2016 gives the go-ahead to print over 5,500 million 500 notes and 2,200 million 1,000 rupee notes. So if there was a plan in advance to demonetize this currency, then why did the RBI print and disburse such large quantities of notes into circulation? The government had claimed that the note ban decision was taken by the RBI. But the RBI said in reply to an RTI in December 2016 that it was the government which advised it to go for demonetization on the 7th of November. An NDTV bureau report.
So, even all these months later, there's still no clarity on just what happened leading up to the 8th of November last year, why demonetization happened, who advised it, and where did it all begin? Joining us on the program tonight, we have Mohan Guruswamy, the chairman of the Center for Policy Alternative Society, Rajesh Mahapatra, the executive editor of the Hindustan Times, Ajoy Kumar of the Congress, and Shubhrastra of the India Foundation still with us, as well as Sunil Alag joining us tonight. Rajesh, let me take this question to you first. Are you still scratching your head, trying to figure this out? Has Raghuram Rajan's book actually left you asking more questions than answering?
Yeah, it clearly has triggered more questions and they need to be answered. I'm not very sure whether we will get all the answers right away. But I wanted to make something very clear, and I think that's where the confusion is coming up. You're talking about these 500 and 2000 rupee notes. Now, Rajan doesn't talk about it in the book, but in an interview, he has said that this was an independent exercise that the RBI had embarked upon, independent of what its views were on demonetization. So please remember that there was a threat of counterfeit currency. That threat had been there much before the talk on demonetization started, you know, the discussion started, as Rajan says, in February. So I think that was part of that independent exercise. We should not confuse that with what Rajan has said in the book. What is coming out very clearly in Rajan's book is that the RBI was never asked to make a decision until his term ended on September 3. Now the government is within its rights to advise. You know, they can go back and forth, but the government can take a call, which is what seems to have happened after September 3rd. Now, the question is that after September 3rd and November 8th, you had barely 10 weeks. And that wasn't clearly not enough for the kind of
preparation,
you know, radical
transition.
I mean, it's 86% of 15.46 lakh crore rupees you are pulling out of the system. That's a big amount. Around the world, across the world, such an exercise in currency transition has never been attempted at. And I think on that count, you could have ignored RBI's advice on the economic benefits versus economic costs. You could have ignored the RBI's advice on whether or not to explore other alternatives. But RBI is the country's chief currency manager. You need to pay heed to RBI's advice. Now, what is coming out very clearly that wasn't done.
So Sunil, let me ask you this. When you heard what Raghuram Rajan has said, it's exactly as Rajesh says, that at least till the 3rd of September, there was nothing that the RBI was asked to do on this. And in fact, he was advising against it. He warned against it, and he just felt that the short-term economic problems would outweigh any long-term benefits from this. And yet the government decided to go ahead. And if it just decided to go ahead in that small 10-week window, was that the wisest thing to do, Sunil?
You know, look, in retrospect, even in November and December, I said it's a great move but badly executed. And what Raghuram Rajan is saying, do not take one sentence out of his book out of context. What he's saying is he also felt that the long-term gains were there, but if you do not plan this exercise properly, then the short-term problems are going to far outweigh the long-term benefits. Now, that's exactly what a lot of us were saying at that point of time. It's not that Raghuram Rajan was saying, don't do it. I mean,
He said there were alternatives. He said he
all
had suggested
he was,
alternatives
if you don't
to demonetization.
Plan it correctly, and I don't think, and I agree. And I agree that it could have been better executed. That's all I'm saying. What made them do it? Even Raghuram Rajan says, look, it's the government's call finally. All economists can advise. There were four or five economists who were saying, do it. Even today, if you read Swaminathan, he's saying, the demonetization has had no impact on the GST. And a lot of people are saying, GDP. The GDP growth rate falling. So there are economists who will have different points of view. Ultimately, the government takes the call. Now, the call was taken whether the actual benefits actually evolved or you actually got unintended benefits now, as Bloomberg has listed out. There are a lot of unintended benefits which have come. So you're getting all kinds of contradictory views, and I agree with that.
It wasn't a well-executed exercise.
That part I agree. But to say that it was a bad one, I don't know.
No, yes, but then the issue, Mohan Guruswamy, is why do it? Why rush to do it if it wasn't that 10-week window? Why rush to do it? Why not plan it better, talk it out, have consultations, whatever you have to do, take more time to mull over it. But why rush through it in that narrow window? Mohan Guruswamy, what do you think?
Nidhi, my understanding is that the RBI was consulted earlier, once before, by a previous government about demonetizing, and the RBI said that we are not ready, it may not be a good idea, so the government dropped it. So this whole thing about, you know, fools rush in, but angels are... this thing was done in a hurry. Clearly, the RBI didn't know about it till September 3rd, and November 8th it was done. I think it rammed down the RBI. It didn't have a strong enough governor. The governor was just new and, you know, untested, untried, and he fell for it. And I think we paid the price hugely for it. There's a huge amount of fear about counterfeit notes in circulation. I've discussed it. I've received briefing papers at several times for track two discussions, and none of that counterfeit notes have come out because RBI was not ready. You didn't have enough machines to unearth counterfeit notes. So banks just received it and went off to the RBI. Has all been accounted for. So what the exercise has done, in addition to what it has cost us, is that counterfeit notes have now become legal.
But, you know, the important...
So I think...
One of the more important things that Raghuram Rajan has talked about, Shubhrastra, in the book, is that, how he had emphasized that he says the RBI handed over a note to the government outlining the potential cost and benefits of scrapping this high denomination currency. And the note emphasized that the kind of preparation that would be required to do such an exercise and what would happen if that preparation was inadequate. And now it's pretty clear, Shubhrastha, isn't it, when you look at the figures and the fact that 99% of the money has come back to the RBI, that a minuscule amount in that, a really, really, really minuscule amount of that is actually fake currency, which was supposed to have been one of the original goals of this note ban. In a sense, are we paying the price for that bad preparation? Should the government have listened to Raghuram Rajan? Shubhrastha.
Of course we are paying for the bad preparation. Raghuram Rajan was the man who would have known.
Yeah, well, I'm just asking Shubhrastha that question. Go ahead, Shubhrastha.
Nidhi, with benefit of hindsight, we can, we have a lot of data on the table right now. We can asphyxiate data into giving the kind of narrative we wanted to give. The other data says that, in 2016-17, there were 300 digital transactions. In 2017-18, it has grown up by 8 to 9 times. You know, when we look at PAN cards, 1 lakh PAN cards were issued every day prior to this year. And from this, pre-demonetization, post-demonetization, 2 to 3 lakh PAN cards are being issued every day. So this is another set of data that we can debate on. But we wouldn't want to go on that debate for obvious reasons.
I'm asking about what Shri Raghuram Rajan said. Shubhrastha, no, I'm sticking to this data because there were some three clear objectives when demonetization was announced by the Prime Minister. One was dealing with fake currency. The other was bringing back black money. And neither has happened. Neither of those objectives were reached, and I'm asking in hindsight, when we look at Raghuram Rajan's note, when we look at the RBI's note to the government warning about what would happen if there is inadequate preparation, do you believe that it was a mistake to have ignored that advice?
Nidhi, I'm sure most citizens in this country heard Prime Minister's passionate speech on the eve of demonetization. And I clearly remember 5 to 10% of the time in his speech he devoted to imploring to the people that certain tough measures have been taken and people will have to cooperate. So I wouldn't think that the objective of demonetization was not behavioral change. It certainly was. And this data that I quoted right now is unprecedented.
It was not the stated objective when the Prime Minister made his speech that day. The narrative was changed a couple of weeks later and digitization suddenly became...
I completely disagree.
No, it wasn't. It's there. It's a fact. The Prime Minister didn't talk about digital India or cashless transactions.
It was a war against corruption.
But I'm just saying those objectives weren't borne out. Ajoy Kumar wants to come in. Ajoy, go ahead.
And Nidhi,
One second, Shubhrastha. Just let me get an initial comment. I'll come back to you. Yes, go ahead, Ajoy.
All right.
You know... When people like Subrata, you know, dish out data on a TV channel, I would request them to say that the 25 lakh people who have filed income tax return, the rate of growth of income tax return is the lowest in the past 7 years. India Policy Foundation is it's a smart institution. Please put up a white paper on the rate, whether Mr. Modi's time the rate has come down or not, and I will accept publicly if I'm wrong on this issue. The second issue is, what is black money? The fight against black money, the Prime Minister should have the decency to say sorry. If more than 99% has come up because there's some amount of money in Dubai, some amount of money in Nepal which could not be transferred, and the Reserve Bank, Nidhi, waited for the last day to reveal to this country that 99% of the money has come. That was, they had to put up the data on the 31st of August and then the data came out. So my question is, Sunil says that, you know, Subrata and Sunil said that the byproduct is very good. If you go for a cancer treatment and one of the medicine causes hair to grow on your head and you die due to the treatment, is it a good product? So the whole black money, fight about black money, because most of the black money, by the way, it was a political move to win elections, but it was not good for India. Because black money is mostly in real estate and gold and round tripping and, you know, in companies.
The third issue is...
That did terrorism come down? No, it didn't come down. Did counterfeit currency come down? No, it didn't come down. Why doesn't the Prime Minister apologize?
Ajay, look, one second. It'd be very foolish.
Sunil, your logic is, I will quote you on your TV when you say great move and you suddenly have, no, Mr. Alag, today
Ajay,
you seem to say
quiet,
that we are already fine. Advised it was badly
executed. No, one second. Ajay, can I answer you?
Yeah, go ahead, Sunil.
Look, I am questioning you on your facts.
Go ahead.
Look, fake notes, if there were fake notes being printed in Nepal and Pakistan, we have no idea of how much was printed and it's never going to come back. So to turn around and say, oh, so much of fake notes, are we stupid? Are the guys who are stupid who are printing fake notes to come back and put it in the bank? So therefore, okay, we have no knowledge on that.
Nidhi.
What you are right on, and I'm saying again, even I said it in December, that it could have been better executed. Why did the Prime Minister not go for it? Because I don't know, he had in his mind, the more discussions we have on it, we have a great system of leakages, the whole of India will get to know and the purpose of demonetization would be defeated. So that was perhaps his thinking. So when he went in for it on a sudden move without full preparation, I was saying exactly what Raghu Rajam has said, that look, at that time it was not a well executed thing, but was it a bad move? No, it wasn't. That's all I'm saying.
That's not what Raghuram Rajan is saying. Rajesh, that's not what Raghuram Rajan is saying. Let's not.
That's all I'm saying.
No, Raghuram Rajan has not said demonetization is a good thing.
No, I just want to clarify on what Sunil said.
One second, Ajay. I just want to get Rajesh.
One of my submission would be, when we discuss RBI governor's book, and RBI governors are very measured in the words that they pick to speak. I think we must not distort the fact about what Rajan has said. He is referring to longer term benefits getting possibly out, and he's saying possible longer term benefits getting outweighed by economic costs. Now, to respond to Sunil's proposition, there were never any longer term benefits if you did not execute it well. There was an assumption that out of this 15 lakh crore, probably 3 to 4 lakh crore were held in cash, which were black money, and that they would come, they would not come back to the system.
Yeah, that was the government's own estimate.
They would not come back to the system.
When
they don't come back to the system, that would amount to a reduction in the RBI's liability. That will in turn translate into enhancement of RBI's profits, and therefore, with the government and the central bank, there will be lots of money which can be invested for the longer term growth. Now, that never happened. Now we know that all the money has come back. Now, there is no other longer term benefit. Let's be very clear about it. That was the only longer term benefit that people had bet on.